Excellencies, colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed an honor and a distinct pleasure on behalf of the OPCW to introduce our guest speaker this morning, the Acting Undersecretary for Arms Control and International Security of the United States, Rose Gottemoeller. Ms. Gottemoeller was designated as the Acting Undersecretary for Arms Control and International Security by U.S. President Barack Obama in February of this year, while also retaining her role as Assistant Secretary for Arms Control, Verification, and Compliance. Ms. Gottemoeller is an arms control expert and an experienced veteran in the field. She led the U.S. negotiations with the Russian Federation that concluded the New START Treaty, which limits the two countries' nuclear arsenals and maintains strategic stability. Prior to the Department of State in 2000, she became a senior associate with the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, where she also served as the director of Carnegie's Moscow Center from January 2006 to December 2008. Ms. Gottemoeller is visiting the OPCW and speaking with us today as part of the Hague Week on Disarmament and Non-Proliferation. This week has seen a series of events hosted at various locations around the city and sponsored by key partner organizations of the OPCW, including the Hague Municipality, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Netherlands, the Netherlands Forensic Institute, TNO, the Klingendahl Institute, PKV Pax Christi, and the Asser Institute. Many of you have attended one or more of these events, which were linked to the OPCW's 15th anniversary and intended to raise public awareness about WMD, disarmament and non-proliferation, as urgent issues of today's world. We hope that you found these events educational and thought-provoking. This certainly promises to be the case for Undersecretary Gottemoeller's address this morning, which will explore the fascinating topic of arms control in the information age. I would now invite the Undersecretary to the podium to deliver her address.
Thank you very much, Director General, ambassadors, colleagues. It is an honor and a pleasure for me to be here today in this important room that symbolizes the strength of the work you're doing to counter chemical weapons around the world. So I'm very honored to have the opportunity to speak today. Thank you very, very much for this chance. It's very important to be here this week in support of the Hague Week on Disarmament and Non-Proliferation, as well as the 15th anniversary of the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. We can all be proud of the great strides we have made in eliminating an entire category of weapons of mass destruction since the convention's entry into force in 1997. We will soon be approaching another important anniversary. The Cuban Missile Crisis happened 50 years ago this October. We have come a long way since then, but today arms control is at a crossroads. We are facing new challenges and entering new terrain. We have not tried to limit non-deployed or non-strategic weapons before, which President Barack Obama called for the day that he signed the New START Treaty in April of 2010 in Prague. We are thinking about how we would verify reductions in those categories of weapons, and people have different ideas even about what terms like non-strategic weapons means. Even more complicated, the lower the numbers of weapons and the smaller the components we're looking at, the harder it will be to monitor compliance of nuclear arms reduction treaties. To make matters even more complicated, the matters you deal with, other weapons of mass destruction, chemical and biological weapons, pose even greater verification challenges because many aspects of them are dual use in nature and difficult to disentangle from normal industrial or commercial processes. In order to deal with these new challenges, we're going to need innovative ideas about how together we can improve and augment the tools needed for verification of treaties and agreements controlling weapons of mass destruction, as well as creating new ones. Today, I'd like to talk to you about one such idea, the incorporation of publicly available technologies and information and social networking into arms control verification and monitoring. It is important to point out right here at the outset that this is not a formal and official policy speech. This is an ideas speech. And I've been speaking a lot to audiences around Europe, in different locales in the United States, including to student audiences, to try to pull forth some new ideas about how the fruits of the information revolution can serve the purposes of monitoring and verifying arms control treaties and agreements. We have ambitious goals, and we will need big new ideas to meet these goals. It is also important to note that while I will focus on arms control today, these ideas could lend themselves to non-proliferation policy, safeguards policy, as well. Nowadays, we verify that countries are fulfilling their arms control treaty obligations through a combination of information exchange, notifications of weapon status, on-site inspections, and national means, including national technical means. NTM are big assets, observation satellites, phased array radars that individual countries manage and control. It has long been a rule of arms control treaties that we don't interfere with each other's national technical means. We allow each other these eyes and ears to monitor treaties. All the elements I've listed off work together to make for an effective verification regime. I should say what we mean in the United States by effective verification. Ambassador Paul Nitze defined it as follows. I quote, "If the other side moves beyond the limits of the treaty in any militarily significant way, we would be able to detect such violations in time to respond effectively and thereby deny the other side the benefit of the violation." In our view, that is effective verification, and it has been the benchmark for verifying compliance in the US. To help meet this benchmark, I've been asking myself, can we incorporate publicly available information technologies and social networking into arms control verification and monitoring? Our new reality is a smaller, increasingly networked world where the average citizen connects to cyberspace hundreds of times a day. These people are exchanging and sharing ideas on a wide variety of topics. Why not put this vast problem-solving entity to good use? Today, any event, anywhere on the planet, can be broadcast globally in seconds. That means it is harder to hide things. When it is harder to hide things, it is easier to be caught. The neighborhood gaze is a powerful tool. It can help us make sure that countries are following the rules of arms control treaties and agreements. How exactly can publicly available information technologies improve arms control verification? Social verification can take place on a scale that moves from active participation, such as public reporting and crowdsourced mapping and analysis, to passive participation, such as ubiquitous sensing or data mining and analytics. On this scale, the open source information technologies in use can improve arms control verification in at least two ways, either by, on the one hand, generating new information, or on the other, by analyzing information that is already available, that is already publicly available. Let me give you some ideas so you'll understand a little better what I'm talking about. In 2009, in recognition of the 40th anniversary of the Internet, the U.S. Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, held a competition where 10 red weather balloons were moored at visible locations around the continental United States. The first team to identify the location of all 10 balloons won a sizable cash prize, $40,000. Over 4,300 teams composed of an estimated 2 million people from 25 countries took part in the challenge. A team from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology won the challenge, identifying all balloon locations in an astonishingly short time of 8 hours and 52 minutes. Of course, to win in such a short time, or to complete the challenge at all, the MIT team did not find the balloons themselves. They tapped into social networks using a unique incentive structure that not only incentivized people to identify balloon locations, but also incentivized them to recruit others to the team. The MIT win showed the enormous potential of social networking and also demonstrated how incentives can motivate large populations to work toward a common goal. Another example involving social networking is already being incorporated into local safety and emergency response systems in the United States. The Raven 911 system, Regional Asset Verification and Emergency Network, is a multi-layer mapping tool that supports emergency first response in Cincinnati, Ohio. Raven 911 uses live data feeds and intelligence gathered through Twitter to provide details that cannot be given on an everyday geographic map, such as the location of downed electric power lines or flooded roads. Authorities are cooperating with communities throughout the region to develop and implement this emergency management system in order to help fire departments assess risks and potential dangers before they arrive at the scene of an accident or of an incident. This open source system gives emergency responders a common operating picture to better execute time-critical activities such as choosing evacuation routes out of flooded areas. In addition to collecting useful data, the ability to identify patterns and trends in social networks can aid the arms control verification process. In the most basic sense, social media can draw attention to both routine and abnormal events. We may be able to mine Twitter data to understand where strange effluents are flowing or to recognize unexpected patterns of industrial activity at a chemical production plant. In this way, we may be able to ensure better compliance with existing arms control treaties and regimes, such as the Chemical Weapons Convention. Does this sound far-fetched? Just consider that even today, tablets such as your iPads have tiny accelerometers attached. That's what tells the tablet which way is up. But the accelerometers also have the capability to detect small shakes, such as earth tremors. Now imagine a whole community of tablet users, all connected, containing an Earthshake app, dispersed randomly around the country and connected into a centralized network node. An individual shake could be something as simple as bumping your iPad against a table, but a whole network of tablets all shaking at the same time? That tells you that something happened. Knowing where all the tablets are and the exact time that they started shaking can help you to geolocate the event. It could be an earthquake, or it could be an illicit nuclear test. Of course, other sensors and other analysis would have to be brought to bear to figure out the difference. This is called ubiquitous sensing, that is, collecting data and basic analysis through sensors on smartphones and other mobile computing devices. These sensors would allow citizens to contribute to detecting potential treaty violations and could build a bridge to stronger public-private partnerships in the realm of treaty verification. Since we are here at the OPCW, I want to dive a little deeper into how this can apply to the Chemical Weapons Convention. Compliance with the CWC is already monitored through a comprehensive international system of declaration and international inspections. Could this already robust system be further integrated with open source information, providing independent confirmation of official conclusions? It is something to think about. The advisory panel on future priorities of the OPCW has already identified this as an idea worth studying when it recommended that the organization should seek to find acceptable ways of using open source information to enhance the verification process back in 2011. Open source information covers a wide variety of data, including general media stories, self-reporting from companies, and information officially released by governments. A recent informal paper from the Technical Secretariat noted that open source information can support the work of the Secretariat and of states' parties in the implementation of the CWC and the task of ensuring destruction of chemical weapons and working to prevent their reemergence. The paper details a number of ways that publicly available information is already used within the Secretariat for purposes related to verification. The paper goes on to suggest several additional ways that publicly available information might be applicable. I applaud this effort to explore these ideas, whether or not these particular suggestions turn out to be useful to the organization. Now let me turn in conclusion to the challenges ahead. Of course, for any of these ideas to work, there are technical, legal, and political barriers ahead that will need to be overcome. It is no easy feat to pursue these ideas. On the technical front, it will be necessary to work together to make sure that nations or industries cannot spoof or manipulate public verification challenges that they devise. We also have to bear in mind that there could be limitations based on the freedoms available to citizens in particular countries. On the legal front, there are many questions that must be confronted about active versus passive participation. How can we prevent governments from extracting information from citizens without their knowledge or manipulating results collected in databases? Further, in some circumstances, how can active participants be sheltered from reproach by authorities? It may be possible through careful handling and management to mask sources of information, even if their locations are public. On the political front, we cannot assume that information will always be so readily available. As nations and private entities continue to debate the line between privacy and security, it is possible to imagine that we are now living in a golden age of open source information that will be harder to take advantage of in the future. So these questions, too, deserve to be contemplated. In the end, the goal of using open source information technology and social networks should be to augment our existing arms control verification capabilities. And I challenge this community to think about how it can be done. As I leave here today, I challenge you to help us find new ways to use the new information tools at our disposal to move the world closer to successfully tackling the control and elimination of all weapons of mass destruction. If we were clever enough to invent these weapons, then surely we must be clever enough to get rid of them. Thank you very, very much for your attention this morning, and I will be happy to answer any questions or hear your comments. So thank you. I appreciate your attention.